Getting pushed around by pistons? Redstone from Zero is here to help. Hi, I'm MistRazor, and welcome back to Redstone from Zero, a tutorial series that teaches you Redstone, assuming you come in knowing absolutely nothing about it. Today's episode is about pistons and sticky pistons. If you haven't already, I recommend starting at the beginning of the series. Episode 0 is linked in the description. But especially, I recommend watching episode 2 on quasi-connectivity before this one. I promise, it's much less scary than it sounds. And I say that because when you use what you learned in this episode to build piston-based machines, you'll probably encounter strange behavior sometimes. And when a piston is acting strangely, your very first thought should be, is quasi-connectivity causing this? Okay, enough plugging episode 2. Let's talk about pistons. There are two kinds of pistons. Pistons and sticky pistons. There's only one difference between pistons and sticky pistons. And that is, when a sticky piston retracts, it pulls the block back with it. Other than that, they're exactly the same. So from now on, when I say piston, that also includes sticky pistons. I'll only mention sticky pistons specifically when talking about things a regular piston can't do. So the first thing to know about pistons is that they have a push limit. They can only push up to 12 blocks. So we will show you. This one has 12 blocks. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. And as you can see, this one has one more, so 13. And when we activate this lever, this one pushes and this one doesn't, because it can only push up to 12 blocks. Once you hit 13 blocks, even if you power the piston, it doesn't extend. And in case you were wondering, sticky pistons also have a pull limit of 12. But the only way to actually make that happen to demonstrate it is to use slime blocks or honey blocks, which we're not going to be covering today. So I'll only show you the other kind of pull limit, which is that when a sticky piston retracts, it only pulls back the block that it is immediately touching, not the other blocks that it may have pushed. In addition to the 12 block push limits, there also exists blocks that aren't pushable or pullable at all. The most well-known example is probably obsidian, which, along with crying obsidian, can't be pushed or pulled. In Java Edition, any block with an inventory, such as a furnace, can't be pushed or pulled. These are sometimes called block entities or tile entities. Anvils in Java Edition can't be pushed unless they're falling, and they can never be pulled at all. As you can see, once it started falling, then we were able to push it. Glazed terracotta blocks are notable in that they can be pushed, but not pulled. And there are other blocks like pumpkins that can be pushed, but break and drop as items when they're pushed. And they can't be pulled at all. Gravity-affected blocks like sand and gravel can be pushed and pulled, except when they're falling, and then they can only be pushed. And even when they're being pushed and pulled, they're affected by gravity like always, so they'll fall if unsupported. In Bedrock Edition, furnaces, anvils, and the like can be pushed and pulled, but anvils still can't be pulled while falling. Other than that, it's mostly the same as Java Edition, but there are a lot of blocks in the game. So I recommend checking out minecraft.wiki/piston for a complete listing of what blocks can and cannot be pushed and pulled in each edition. Editor missed here. I realized that I forgot to mention possibly one of the most important examples of what pistons can and can't push and pull. So, a piston can push and pull other pistons unless that piston is extended, in which case it can't do anything at all. So, remember that. And while we're in Bedrock Edition, we might as well talk about one of the other big differences between Bedrock and Java Edition as far as sticky pistons are concerned. And that is one-tick pulses. So, when we give a one-tick pulse to a sticky piston in Bedrock Edition, this is what happens. It pushes the block out and then immediately pulls it back. And that's probably what you'd expect to happen, right? But in Java Edition, that's not what happens. So, when we apply a one-tick pulse to a sticky piston here, it pushes it out and leaves it there. And then when we do it again, it grabs it and pulls it back. And this only happens for one-tick pulses. Any longer, and it does exactly what Bedrock Edition does. It just pushes it out and then pulls it back. I don't know exactly why this happens, but I do know that it is completely consistent. It always happens. If you apply a one-tick pulse to a piston, it will either push the block out and leave it, or pull the block in, if it's already out. All right. Now that we've covered the basic properties of pistons and sticky pistons, let's talk about cool things that you can do with them. First off will be a pulse shortener. We've already talked about pulse lengthening in a previous episode, but now we can talk about pulse shortening. A basic pulse shortener looks like this. You have a sticky piston facing up, and then you have a building block on top of it, and a redstone repeater leading into it. And remember that when the redstone repeater strongly powers this block, that means that this block will become able to power redstone dust that's touching it. So what happens here is when we power it, it both strongly powers this block here, which sends a redstone signal through this redstone dust, and it powers the sticky piston, which pushes the block and cuts off the signal. And the result of that means that just the barest, tiniest amount of redstone signal gets through. And as you can see, that is a one tick pulse on this sticky piston, which made it push this block out. So I'll show you again. When we power it, if you look, you could just barely see these turn bright red for just a split second. And every time I power this, it toggles the position of this smooth stone block because this is getting a one tick pulse and it's making it pull it back or push it out and leave it. And now if we combine the pulse shortener with a one tick sticky piston, we can make something called a T flip flop. And I'll show you how useful that is in just a second. But first I'll show you how to build the T flip flop. You start off with a basic pulse shortener. And then we add on another sticky piston and a redstone block, and then we have redstone dust coming out of it. Notice that it's not connected to the redstone block currently. And then we hook up some sort of switch or lever or button or anything really to the redstone repeater here. And then when you activate it, this one tick pushes this out the first time you press it, and then it pulls it back the next time. So what we've created here is something a lot like a lever, where when you activate it once, it turns on. The next time you activate it, it turns off. Activate it again, turns back on, and activate it one more time, turns off. This does exactly the same thing. On, off, on, off. And why is this useful? Especially since we already have levers in the game. The reason why it's useful is because a redstone machine can activate this, whereas a redstone machine is not capable of activating a lever. So if you wanted to rig something up in your base such that the lights turn on whenever you walk over a pressure plate, so that way when you walk into your base, all the lights turn on, and then the lights turn off when you leave, you can use one of these to do that. And you couldn't do that with a lever without making people manually turn the lights on and turn the lights off. In this case, it's automatic. Whenever you walk over the pressure plate, it toggles the state. And yeah, it seems like a bit of a contrived example right now, but later on, the T flip flop is going to be very useful. For now, you can just think of it as something that makes buttons and pressure plates act like levers. And finally, that brings us to the last cool thing that we're going to be building this episode, a double piston extender. Recall from earlier how a piston can be pushed and pulled, but only if it itself isn't extended. So when we have this piston extended, and we try to push this one, nothing happens. This means that while it's possible to use multiple pistons to push a block multiple spaces, you have to power the pistons in the correct order to make that happen. So we power this one, and then we power this one, and we can have it push two blocks, or have this block push two spaces instead of one. And even more importantly, it means that if you want to use multiple pistons to pull a block more than one space, you have to unpower the pistons in the correct order to make that happen. Because if we try unpowering this one first, well, then this gets stuck here, and when we unpower it, it didn't fully retract. So instead, we have to unpower this one, and then unpower this one. And then we have to power this one again, and unpower it. And the more pistons you have here, the more complicated it gets. To the point where if you're going to do more than a double piston extender, I usually just use a flying machine, which I will cover in a later episode. So rule of thumb that you can remember is you can do a double piston extender, generally not worth it to do more than a double piston extender. You should probably just use a flying machine in that case. All right, so now I'll take you through the process of building a double piston extender, starting from a naive example that doesn't work. This is both just to show the principles in action, as well as to give you an idea of what developing a redstone contraption can look like. So we'll start with two sticky pistons, both pointing up, and then we'll put gravel on top of them, because they're gravity blocks, and so that means we don't have to pull them back down, they'll just fall, which is really nice and useful. Then we will Here, we'll do some redstone dust here. We'll put a building block there and there. Put redstone dust on this and this, and then we'll throw a lever on there, and we'll power it, and everything's gonna work, and it's just gonna be super easy, right? Well, no, not exactly. They both power up like this, but then when we take the power away, whoops, this gets stuck up here. Okay, so not as easy of a solution as we thought, but we can work with this. So I guess all we have to do here is just break that for a second, pull it back down, and now we've got a good starting point again. Okay, so the problem was that even though both of these pushed up correctly, this one went and then this one went, when we depower them, this one pulls back before this one pulls back. And what we want is for this one to retract and then this one to retract, so that way this will pull this down. And so the way that we can do that is by throwing in a redstone repeater. Let's just pull that back down. But when we do that, then we'll extend it again, and you'll see that because there's a delay here, that means that this piston gets powered first, and now we can't push it up anymore. So, well, that's a no-go. So maybe what we need to do is make it so that way the redstone power isn't available right here. It's just available one block higher. So maybe what we need to do is do this. Put that block there. Another block like that. And we'll put that there. And remember that this is a transparent block, so it's not going to power this block underneath, which means that we're not going to have to worry about quasi-connectivity powering this gravel here and making the piston go up. Hi, it's Editor Mist again. This block doesn't actually have to be transparent, because even though an opaque block here would power the piston via quasi-connectivity, it's powering it indirectly, and in this case it doesn't have the necessary block update to make the piston extend, so it's nothing to worry about if it's opaque. Just so you know. So we'll throw a lever on here. That part looks good. You'll see that this one didn't extend until it was pushed up to come into contact with this redstone. Then when we retract it, still have the same problem that they retracted at the same time, or this one retracted too early, essentially. So we will, fix that. Pull those down. So what we actually need to do is have more of a delay on this. And the reason why is because even if this gets powered immediately, it doesn't matter, because this one is not going to be pushed up to be able to get the redstone signal from it yet. So we can afford for this to be delayed in starting to push this. And then once it's powered and we're depowering it, because this has the 2-tick delay, it means that this top piston will depower, and then the signal will make its way through this repeater, and then this one will depower, meaning that we depowered in the correct order. First top, then bottom. So it goes up, and then it goes right back down. And you can do this in any orientation. So if we have them going like this, and then we'll have a 2-tick delay here, and then we put our lever here, double piston extension, and it pulls back. And now I'll show you a beautiful application of a double piston extender, something you can do in your own base. If you watched Hyrule's Season 1, you may remember the gate used in Bee and Jasmine's base. When you push the upper button, the top double piston extender activates, pushing the portcullis down. And when you press the lower button, the bottom double piston extender activates, using the concrete powder to push the portcullis back up. And when the double piston extender is done, the concrete powder falls back into place, leaving the gate open to walk through. And when we look at the redstone inside of it, we can see that we indeed have a 2-tick delay leading into the bottom sticky pistons, and then just a regular redstone signal leading to the top two sticky pistons. Before we end, let's review the concepts we talked about today. 1. The only difference between a piston and a sticky piston is that a sticky piston can pull as well as push. 2. All pistons have a 12-block push and pull limit. If you try to have them move more than 12 blocks, they'll just sit there when you power them instead of doing anything. You can, however, have multiple pistons side by side, each pushing its own 12 blocks to move something that's more than 12 blocks total. 3. Some blocks can't be pushed or pulled, like obsidian. Some blocks can be pushed but not pulled, like glazed terracotta. In Java Edition, blocks with an inventory can't be pushed or pulled, but in Bedrock Edition, they can be pushed and pulled. For a full listing, go to minecraft.wiki/piston, link in the description. 4. One-tick pulses allow a sticky piston to push and then let go of a block, but only in Java Edition. In Bedrock Edition, you can't use one-tick pulses to unstick a block from a sticky piston. 5. When making a double piston extender, the most important part is powering and depowering the pistons in the correct order. 6. Multiple piston extenders start getting very complicated very quickly once you go past the double piston extender. Consider using a flying machine, which I'll cover in a later video, instead of a triple or more piston extender. As always, if you have a question, or something was confusing, leave a comment and I'll do my best to clear things up for you. And if you found this video useful, don't forget to like and subscribe if you haven't already. It helps out the channel a lot. And with that, thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye!